Welcome to ISC Plus One History class. We are going to continue with the same lesson. Lesson 2, Emergence of Colonial Economy. Before going through the lesson, we will understand the objectives of the lesson. We had already discussed about the development of means of transport and communication. We had discussed about plan for building of railways, disruption of traditional economy. In the last session, we had discussed about the revenue policies of the British, including the permanent settlement and Rayothwari system. In this session, we will discuss these two objectives. We will discuss the development of modern industries in India, and we will discuss the colonial forest policies and its impact on local communities. First, we will go through the new terms. Entrepreneur, a person who makes money by running business, especially when this involves taking financial risk. Famine, extreme scarcity of food. Predominance, the state of being more important than other things. Foreign capital, the inflow of money in home country from abroad. Capitalist, the person who invests money in some business to earn profit. Slums, an area of a city where living conditions are extremely bad. Unhindered, with nothing stopping or preventing somebody from progressing. Memorandum, a written message in business or diplomacy. Draconian, excessively harsh and severe law. And the last term is intruder, a person who enters a place secretly without permission. The British India was characterized by poverty and famines. The two of India's greatest economists before independence, Dadabhai Naroji and Ramesh Chandra Dutt, by their books called Poverty and Un-British Rule in India and Economic History of India, declared that the British government was doing total economic exploitation of India as they were exporting the raw material from India to England and importing the machine-made goods from England to India. According to both these economists, there was huge level of poverty in India and frequent famines in different provinces like UP, Bombay, Punjab, Maharashtra and Karnataka. Unlike today, Bombay was not a part of Maharashtra. Bombay Presidency was a separate province and Maharashtra was a separate province. So, according to these intellectuals, the British had totally economically exploited the India, and they severely criticized this policy of the British. So, under pressure of the intellectual class, the British decided that they would develop the modern industries in India. So, industrialization also started in India. Firstly, they developed the agricultural industries because these were the raw materials which were required in the textile industries in England. So they developed cotton, cotton threads, jute, sugar and tea. After that, they developed the jute industry. The first jute mill was established in Risda. It is a place near Calcutta in 1855. Then, due to expansion of railways in India, the demand for coal and iron was increased. So, the development of coal and iron industry was there. And because of the interest of the British planters in Assam and other hilly areas for tea plantation, there was expansion of tea industry. But all these industries were developed in eastern part of India, especially Calcutta. The East India Company was not able to set up its factories and industries in the western part like Gujarat, Maharashtra and Bombay. There were many reasons for that. We will go through what were the reasons why the East India Company failed to set up industries in western India. The first reason was investment by Parsi community. The Parsi community was in predominance in Gujarat and Maharashtra. They had accumulated a lot of wealth as they were having trade relation with China and East Asia. So they had already invested in cotton textile mills there, so there was no scope for East India Company to invest in the Western India. The Western India was dominated by Marathas, and the Marathas have restricted the entry of British merchants in the Western India, so they could not establish their monopoly in the western part of India. Before expansion of railways, no means of transportation was there between Bombay and other parts of country, so East India Company was not successful in setting up industry in this part of the country. No cheap supply of agrarian raw material was there, like the British wanted tea, jute and coal. This was only available in the eastern part of India, especially Calcutta. The western part was mainly known for cotton, and they were not able to get the supply of agrarian raw material from western part, so they also did not show so much interest in doing investment here. Then imported machine were there in this part from England. We had already discussed that the Parsi community was very wealthy here. They have already brought machines from England, and they were producing the fine quality of clothes. In western part of India, they had set up many cotton textile mills in Gujarat and Bombay, so there was no scope for the country to do investment there. The mill owners of the western part of India, like Bombay and Gujarat, they supported Swadeshi and boycott movement. This we had already discussed in the last lesson. And because the industrialists supported there, so the common people also supported the Swadeshi and boycott movement, and they showed interest in buying only indigenous goods rather of buying the foreign goods. Now we will do the economic impact of growth of industries. Modern industries were set up in India, and it affected the Indian economy. We will go through what were its effect. Emergence of new social classes. Before industrialization in India, there were only two social classes. One was zamindars and second was peasants. Now, with the help of industrialization, two new social classes emerged. One was capitalist and second was workers. Capitalist, we have already done in new terms. Capitalist means a person who invests in order to earn profit, and workers were the laborers who were working in his factories. There was development of new towns, as industries were not set up in the rural areas. They had to be set up in the outskirts of some big cities. So new industrial towns were set up in India, which led to urbanization. People from rural areas came out to these towns in search of jobs. Because of urbanization, there was expansion of slums. Slums also we have discussed in the new terms. It is a part of a city where the living conditions are very bad. And why it's bad? Because the slums were having poor sanitation conditions. The hygiene was not good here. The houses, the buildings were dirty, and it was not possible for the government to give them water supply in the slums area. So these slums were developed in the cities. There was ruination of cottage industry. The cottage industry totally was deteriorated, and India became a market for selling finished goods. Now we will discuss the colonial forest policies. Apart from developing the modern industries in India, British also took interest in the forest policy of India. In the ancient time, the forest were under the common people. The common people used to be the owners of the forest, and they could use them according to their own wish. In the medieval period or in the Mughal period, the rulers or the zamindars became the owners of the forest. Lord Dalhousie was the first Governor General who took interest in the forest policy of India. In 1855, he issued Charter of Indian Forest. Then in 1856, he made Mr. Dietrich Brandes, a German botanist, the Inspector General of Forest. Then the Dietrich Brandes, the same person, set up the first ever forest department in India. Now, the British government thought that the laws had to be made to manage the forest in India. So, three different laws were made. One was Indian Forest Act of 1865, second was Indian Forest Act of 1878, and the third was the Land Acquisition Act of 1894, and we will discuss all these acts now. The Indian Forest Act of 1865, the government was empowered, the government was given the power to declare any land covered with trees as government forest and makes rule to regulate and manage them. That means if government could see anywhere the trees, the government can declare that it is a government forest and government can make rules in order to regulate the forest. Then Indian Forest Act was passed in 1878. It categorized the trees into three different categories: reserved forest, protected forest and village forest. People didn't have any right on forest except village forest. That means the people were having ownership on village forest. The first two parts, the reserve forest and the protected forest, were under the authorities. They were under the British rule. So because reserved and forest and the protected forest were under the authority of the British rule, deforestation or cutting of the trees started here, and especially this was done for selling the timber. The Land Acquisition Act of 1894 was passed. It was not directly implied on the forest, but government ultimately implemented this on the forest also. It means that the government can acquire any private property for public purpose, like setting up of schools or industries, from individual after paying him compensation for loss of property. That means government would pay some money to the person and acquire any property, including the forest, for any public purpose, and the person cannot deny. Now we will discuss what was the impact of this forest policy on local communities, the local people. The traditional right of people on forest was taken away, as we have discussed that in the ancient time, the people were having the right over the forest. That right was taken away by these legislation acts. Collection of woods for domestic use and pasturing of cattle was denied. The people cannot use the woods or the trees for their domestic purpose. Then the people started protest against the government, but they all protest were in vain. They were not successful because they were easily crushed by the British government. I hope you have understood till here. With the help of this explanation and internet, you are advised to make the notes of above topic. Thank you.